आज शब्बीर पे क्या आलम तन्हाई है, आज शब्बीर पे क्या आलम तन्हाई है, जुल्म की चांद पे जहरा के घटा छाई है, उस तरफ लश्कर आदा में सफारा, या न बेटा न भतीजा न कोई भाई, या न बेटा न भतीजा न कोई भाई, बर्छियाँ खाते चले आते हैं तलवार, मार लो प्यासे को है शोर सितमगार, मार लो प्यासे को है शोर सितमगारों, जख्मी बाजू हैं कमर खम है बदन में, नहीं था डगमगाने में निकल जाती है कदमों से, प्यास का गलबा है लब खुश्क है आंखें, तब से देते हैं हर वार का आदा कुछ, तब से हर वार का आदा कुछ, शिद्दत जोर से जिस जा पे ठहर जाते हैं, सैकड़ों तीरे सितम तन से गुजर जाते हैं, सैकड़ों तीरे सितम तन से गुजर जाते, बर्छिया कर कोई सीने पे लगा जाता, मारता है कोई नैजा तो गशा जाता, बढ़ते हैं जख्म बदन जोर घटा जाता, बंद आंखें है सरे पार झुका जाता, गिर्द जहराओ अली गिरिया कुना फिर, गुल है घोड़े से इमाम दो सरा गिरते, गुल है घोड़े से इमाम दो सरा गिरते, कोई सैयद का नहीं आह बचाने वाला, हर बेला खो है और एक जख्म उठाने वाला, प्यास में कोई नहीं पानी पिलाने भला, बर्छियाँ खाने वाला समले किस तरह भला, बर्छियाँ खाने वाला चरख से आग बरसती है जमी जलती है, मार गर्मी के दबा खुश्क है लूचा, आखिरी बंदी दम कहीं दम लेने को साया है नहीं, वक्त दम ऐठ जाती है जबा प्यास की शिद्दत, عالم تنہائی ہے. Now without any delay, I will request Sheikh Jaleel to come on the member for Muhammad Ali Muhammad Salawat.
الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيبي وحبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين ذاب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. Humbly request of Surah Al-Fatiha for the ruh of marhum Sayyid Faiz Ahmed Zaidi, son of Sayyid Ali Muhammad. May Allah be pleased with his soul. Al-Fatiha. And also for your marhumeen and marhumat and marhumeen of our community, Surah Al-Mubarakat Al-Fatiha. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قل هو الله أحد. الله الصمد. لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد. الله الصمد. لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. صلوا. قال الله العلي العظيم في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. صدق الله العلي العظيم. Per the request of the family of Marhum for tonight, so requested to talk about what we call falsafatu siyam, the philosophy of fasting. What is the meaning of philosophy? Now, by the way, as you know, the word philosophy is a Greek word. For those who started the philosophy was the Greeks. And Muslims also learned from them, and then the adopted ones, that's called Islamic philosophy. What works for the Muslims, yes, based on our aqidah and our belief, they took it. What doesn't work according to Islam, they leave it. But actually, the word philosophy came from Greek. And the word falsafa in Arabic, it means al-hikmah, which means wisdom. That's what it means. So in Islam, when we say falsafa to shay, meaning the wisdom of something. So when we say about falsafa to siyam, which is the philosophy of fasting, it means the wisdom behind why Islam prescribed fasting. Because a lot of times people ask, Why would Islam or Allah want people to be hungry and thirsty? What would Allah gain from my thirst and from my hunger? That is the question. But the answer to this question, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't gain or will not gain anything from your hunger or thirst. Now the one who gains is you and I. And that is why we need to understand what is the philosophy of fasting in the month of Ramadan. Before we talk about the philosophy of fasting, we have to understand something. And that is, ulama al-usul, usul al-fiqh. They said every rule in Islam, every rule, wajib, mustahab, haram, makruh, mubah, any one of them, they have two rules applied to them. One rule is called al-hukm al-mansus al-ilm, meaning there are two kinds of rule in Islam. Certain rules in Islam, whether it's wajib or haram or mustahab or makruh, Allah tells you why we made this rule. Why this rule was made to become haram or wajib. These rules, they are called al-ahkam al-mansus al-ilm, which means rules that the reason and wisdom of why this rule was made is mentioned to. I'll give you one example. When you go to the Quran, Quran tells you and I that when you want to give somebody a loan, somebody was loaned, and you know this is one of the highly recommended ibadah in Islam. Giving loan in Islam is highly recommended and is better than giving sadaqah. In other words, if somebody is going to take a loan from me versus giving somebody sadaqah, Islam prefers the one taking loan over the one taking sadaqah. Allama Shaheed al-Thani, he explains why. The hikmah. He says the hikmah is sadaqah can reach to anybody. Sometimes they don't even need, but they take sadaqah anyway. But loan, in many cases, people who are in need are the one who ask for it. So, in sadaqah, you might give somebody who needs or somebody who might not need. But loan, for the majority part, it goes to the needy. So, you are giving loan, you are definitely helping someone. That is why this loan is taken serious in Islam. Now, in Islam, when somebody wants to give a loan, Quran says in Surah Al-Baqarah, Quran says, you the one giving and you the one collecting, you have to bring two witnesses. Allah says two witnesses have to be there. Now, why do they have to be there? It's not a business. Allah says their business. Why? Because there is death. Me the giver, I can die tomorrow. Or the collector can die tomorrow. Then how do we secure the money of this person who is doing the khayr? You have to be two witnesses. And Quran said the witness have to be two. And two male. Two male have to be one. Ya Rab, we don't have two male. Allah said, if you don't have two male, then come with the one male and two females. Two females. Now here comes the females. Why two females instead of one? That's just what they ask, right? Ya Allah, I said two male, but there is no two male. For one male, you bring two. Why? Why not one male, one female? Now listen to the answer of Quran. Illa. The reason why Islam make this rule for the sisters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Anta dhilla ihdahuma fatudhakkiraha al-ukhra." Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says the wisdom, the reason why we made this rule, because women by nature, they easily forget. Now we all forget. We all forget, right? But I'm going to tell you something, sisters. They easily forget everything, but not when the husband did something wrong. They can easily forget everything. How much you spend on them, how much you do, they can easily forget. But one thing they don't forget easily, when you wrong them, that never wipes in their brain. But the Quran says, "Anta dhill ahdahuma al-dhalal," meaning forgetfulness. They easily forget. So Allah said, because of that, in case one of them forget, Allah said, فَتُذَكِّرَهَا الْأُخْرَى. Then the next one might forget something which she will remind the other one so that they remember the one agreement. That is called al-hikmah. Now, so here you see Islam has tell us the reason why this rule is made. Now, you come to other rules, the second group of the rules, Islam said, I'm not telling you why I made this rule. Why? So to see if you're gonna surrender, whether you understand or you don't, let me see if you're gonna follow me. So in Islam there are certain rules we obey Allah without even knowing. Now example, you ask Quran, Ya Quran, why do we have to pray Asr 4 rakah? There's no reason for it. There's no ayah in the Quran tells you Allah made the Asr 4 rakah for such and such reason. There's no such thing in the Quran or in the Hadith. Now this is something called, and the orders of Allah that we have to obey even if we don't understand. And sometimes there are certain rules it doesn't make even sense to you and I, but you still have to obey. And that is called Ahkam Ta'abudi. The rules that you have to surrender and obey Allah regardless. Now, in Islam, every ibadah we do, for the most part, even if there is no illah, there is something called hikmah behind it. That Ahlul Bayt, they come to explain, to make you understand even better. One of them is what? Is fasting. Now fasting, what is the hikmah? Why would Islam prescribe such thing? They ask Imam Ali ibn Musa al-Ridha alayhi salam. Ya ibn Rasulullah, why would Allah prescribe fasting upon us to fast and not drink, not eat for the whole day? Imam al-Ridha said, one of the wisdom behind it is equality. To teach us equality. Now what does it mean equality? It's equality in 1 month throughout the year. Allah wants to equal between rich and poor. Why? Imam Radha said, because throughout the year, 11 months, the rich person, he opens his refrigerator, a drink, snacks, lunch, dinner, everything is there. And the poor person who cannot afford goes hours and days without him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribed 1 month in a year where the rich and poor together become equal in the sight of Allah in the act of ibadah. So they are fasting, poor and rich all together, white and black, male and female all together, to be equal in this act of ibadah. That is why today, as we start fasting, or tomorrow, you cannot say, oh, I'm so rich, so I want to hire somebody to fast. No, 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 unless I don't want them. Yeah, but I can afford, I pay them million. And I say, no, it doesn't matter, keep your millions, you'll fast. The poor person, Ya Allah, I cannot. I say, you're all equal. And then they ask Imam al-Ridha, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, okay, we all fast, then what? Then Imam said, the hikmah is here. When the rich person fasts, and after Ramadan, a poor person knocks their door and say, I am hungry, then he, the rich, can relate to the hunger because he tried in the month of Ramadan. Then what is easy to do? To help the poor person because he knows what it feels to be hungry. So the hikmah of fasting in the month of Ramadan is to make equal between between the rich and the poor in the month of Ramadan. That's number one. Number two, one of the hikmah of fasting in the month of Ramadan is to give our organs an off break. You know, we all work in the year, right? And then you have what we call vacation. So you take your mind and your body off the work. You don't have to drive 7 o'clock in the traffic. You take off them this time to this time. Now throughout the year, your organs, they have been working morning, day, night, every time. Allah said once in a year, they need vacation. Your stomach needs a vacation. That 1 month in a year, the stomach, they have to take a break to rest, so that after Ramadan, they gain the strength they need to start working also after the month of Ramadan. And that is one of the hikmah. Because here's the thing. When we start, when we fast, it gives our stomach, especially the digestive system, they give them break throughout the day. And that let them to rest and have more power, that after Ramadan they can go back to the normal schedule of grounding and working as they supposed to. And that is hikmah number two. Number three. You know, fasting is one of the ways to cure diseases. Many of our disease and sickness come from food we eat. And Imam Ali, Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah alayhi, Allahumma sallam. He mentioned in Nahj al-Balagha. And if we can take this as a take-home message from Imam Ali. He says, Al-batnatu baytu dar. He said, your stomach is the house of disease and sicknesses. Now, if you check and ask doctors, 99% of our sickness come from this stomach. What we eat. Then Imam Ali says, وَالْحِمْيَةُ رَأْسُ كُلِّ دَوَى. And the medicine that prevents all the diseases and sickness is to watch what you put in your stomach. What we call in English, protection is better than cure. Now if you check diabetes, where does it come from? From the food we eat. Many of our diseases that today we are facing come from this food. And the moment you start to fast, what it does is a way of Allah making you to become healthier. And that is why Quran said, وَأَن تَصُومُوا خَيْرًا لَكُمْ. That fasting is better for you. Health-wise. That's one of the ways. So when you fast, one of the things it does is to help you to become more healthier. And that's why the hadith of the Prophet says, Sumu tasuhu. Mean fast and you will be healthier. So fasting, one of the ways we are curing some of the diseases is through fasting. And today you and I, we have Tylenol. We have Advil. We have all these medications, right? Now you ask a previous, before all these medications were invented, how did they used to cure some diseases? They say they used to cure diseases through fasting. When people have diseases, they tell them to fast 40 days. They only drink water. And after 40 days, they get cure from those diseases. Fasting can be one of the ways to cure your disease. And that is one of the hikmah of fasting. That's number three. Number four. And this goes to America here in this country. You know, one of the challenges we have in America is obesity. Many of the people in America, they're overweight. And because of that, we have so many organizations. Some of them how to eat food. Some of them, they have these chemicals in there. You register and then 6 months, 3 months, you lose weight. Some of them you have to go through surgeries, right? Now Allah opened an organization free of charge. You don't have to pay anybody anything. You don't have to swap your credit card. You keep your credit card and everything. Just fast 30 days and I guarantee you, you will lose the weight. Free of charge. Huh? Now you try, from tomorrow we start, inshallah, you check your belt, right? After 10 days, you need to adjust it a little bit more. Which means you're losing weight, right? Now how much did you pay to the company? For free. Allah brought this way of losing weight free of charge. And that is one of the blessings of the month of Ramadan. That it helps you to clean yourself from all this fat during the month of Ramadan. And unfortunately, there are some people, During the month of Ramadan, they gain weight too. That's opposite. Right? Because after Ramadan, when they do iftar, that's when they eat and eat and eat and eat. Till suhoor, they keep eating. So instead of losing, they gain. They're losing the purpose of the month of Ramadan. You know, in Islam, according to the Umaraja, they say it's even discouraged in the month of Ramadan to eat too much. Because the purpose of fasting is to make you feel that hunger and the change within yourself toward the month of Ramadan. And that is one of the way we can benefit from the month of Ramadan. Another philosophy of the fasting of the month of Ramadan. One of them is, the month of Ramadan, what it does, it teaches you what we call Ruhul Amana, the spirit of trust. It strengthens your trust. How? You know, in the month of Ramadan, you and I fast. You can go into the bathroom, lock yourself up, open that tap, and drink as much as you want. Nobody's going to see you except Allah. But the trust you have and you believe in Allah, that is watching. You will get in the close places and you're still not drinking because you know Allah sees you. So Ramadan is more about building your trust with Allah. That I know nobody can see me. I can go into a restaurant somewhere, eat and come back. Nobody could see me. But the trust that you have in Allah that He sees you is stronger. So even though you're thirsty, even though you're hungry, you still maintain that trust. And that trust becomes stronger and stronger throughout the month of Ramadan. So the month of Ramadan, one of the benefits is to strengthen the spirit of your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is one of the benefits of the month of Ramadan. Another one of the benefits of the month of Ramadan, that when we fast, one of the blessings that we learn throughout the month of Ramadan is to learn also to be connected to Allah more than any other month as well. Any month, Muharram, Safar, Rabiul Awal, all of this month you connect with Allah. But not as much as in the month of Ramadan. Because in the month of Ramadan, from the morning that you wake up for suhoor, Ahlul Bayt, they taught you dua that you read. Then when you start your fasting, there is dua. Then when you come to Dhuhr, there is dua. After wajib prayer, every wajib, they specifically teach you what to read after your wajib prayer in the month of Ramadan. Then you come after Maghrib, after Isha, there is one dua after dua, a'mal, nawafil, which makes your connection with Allah much stronger in the month of Ramadan compared to any other month. And that is one of the blessings of the month of Ramadan. It brings you much closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala compared to any other month. And that is one of the blessings of the month of Ramadan. Another blessing of the month of Ramadan, it makes a person stronger. Month of Ramadan, fasting, it makes you stronger. How? One of the scholars was giving an example. I said, look, the example of you who is fasting versus somebody who doesn't fast. It's like two trees. One which grows in the middle of desert. Desert, there is no water, there is no rain. The tree that grows in the middle of desert is always stronger. Why? Because that tree has to maintain and survive on a little water it gets. Versus the tree that stands next to water or river all the time. That tree is not strong. The moment a wind blows it, it falls. Because it gets so much water underneath of it. So it doesn't make it stronger. But the tree that stands in the middle of desert where the rain doesn't come, it only survives and maintains itself on the little water it gets. It becomes stronger because it depends on the little water it gets. The same thing, a person who fasts, he or she becomes stronger because they maintain this little food and water during the month of Ramadan. And that itself makes them stronger. Versus people who eat 24 hours. That's why some people, they ask, are you serious that you don't eat and drink through the day? Not even water? But they cannot even imagine. How do you do that? But you as a mu'min, you do it without even feeling it. Because this makes you much stronger. And that is why the companions of 12th Imam, and Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman, they said they're so strong that they can fight for years and months. But what is the secret? You think they take some medication? No, they don't. The secret is one thing. They say kathra to siyam. They were constantly fasting a lot. And that itself built them and made them stronger. Because fasting, what it does, it builds you. Now if you check in California here in America, they made a study. And the study was, what is the best way to build your immune system faster and stronger? One of them, they say, well, it's exercise. It builds your body, right? But when they studied and they found that fasting 3 days consecutive days, they say it gives your immune system and makes it much stronger than anything else in the world. Fasting 3 days consecutive days, it builds your system and makes you stronger compared to exercise, compared to any vitamins, compared to anything you can think of. And that is the blessing of fasting. So when we fast, one of the blessings is it makes us to become stronger. And that is why Ahlul Bayt alayhim assalam, they constantly emphasizing on us fasting and salatul layl and good deeds. A lot of people, they don't understand why Imam Hussein alayhi salam was able to fight those enemies even though he has a few companions. One of the secrets of it is two things. One is kathrat al-siyam and salat al-layl. Because the night of Ashura, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he told the enemies, when they wanted to attack and fight, he told them, do not fight me tonight. Why? He said, because I want to pray and read Quran and take as much as blessing as I can tonight. And that night, truly Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he and his companions, they all spent the entire night between dhikr and salat and recitation of Quran. That's how they spend their night. And that recitation of Quran and that layl, salat al-layl, gave them more energy to fight the next day. And on the day of Ashura, with the fact that Imam Hussein have less companions and less supporters, he was able to fight thousands of people from morning after Fajr till after Zuhr. Where in the world you can see a few group of people fighting so much people? Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that is how his companions were prepared. And not only him, his companions too, his children, like Ali al-Akbar, who was one of the supporters of his father, who saw that thousands of enemies, but did not stop him from standing on his ground. He looked at his father when he heard Imam Hussein was saying, La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Then Ali al-Akbar asked his father, oh my father, is something wrong? Then Imam Hussein said, no my son, but I can see something is coming. He asked his father, what is coming, my father? Imam Hussein said, oh my son, we are getting closer and closer to our death time. As if we are very close to death. Then Ali al-Akbar asked his father, oh my father, are we on the right path or not? Awalasna ala al-haq? Imam Hussein looked at him and he said, oh my son, yes, we are on the right path. Then he looked at his father and he said, oh my father, If we are on the right path, then it shouldn't matter if we run to death or the death run to us. That is Ali al-Akbar. He said, it doesn't matter if we die right now or we die tomorrow. Allahu Akbar. And on the day of Ashura, when the entire companions of Imam Hussein were murdered, and Imam Hussein was calling, Wa qillata nasira, hal min nasirin yansuruna, hal min mu'inin yu'inuna. Is there anywhere, anybody out there to help us? Anyone to come to our aid? Anyone to come to our support? Ali al-Akbar was the first one who came forward. And he says, Ya Aba Ana Nasiruk, I'm your supporter, I'm your helper. Imam Hussein hugged him and put his face on the shoulder of Ali al-Akbar and started crying on the shoulder of Ali al-Akbar. Ali al-Akbar did the same thing, put his face on the shoulder of his father, and they both were crying on the shoulder of one another. You know the secret of their cry? The secret is every father wants to live and die while the children are still alive. Every father wants to die and have his children to bury them. But in the case of Imam Hussein was totally different. He has to witness the martyrdom of his father. He has to bury his own son. Not one, not two. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, that was the reason of his crying. Ali al-Akbar later went to the battlefield and he fought, the narration say, قَاتَلَ قِتَالَ الْأَبْطَالِ. He fought like the heroes of Arabs. And finally, they came surrounded Ali al-Akbar. They started there with their swords and spears and arrows attacking Ali al-Akbar from all angles. Ali al-Akbar called his father, As-salamu alayka ya Aba. Imam Hussein jumped to the aid of his son. He got to the enemies, he fought them. He came to his son, as he picked his son, Ali al-Akbar. He was in his final moment. He looked at his father and he said, with a smile, in that final moment, he says, Ya Aba Hada Jaddi Rasulullah. There's my grandfather Rasulullah. And the other side is my grandfather Amir al-Mu'mineen. They came with the water that I'm looking for. And they told me, Ya Ali, this is a water that you will never be thirsty afterwards. He said, and they told me, Ya Hussein, he said, Hasten, we're waiting for your arrival, Ya Aba Abdullah. Then Imam Hussein alayhi salam, as he was looking at the face of his son, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, saw the departed soul of his son, left the body of his son. Here the narrator said, Imam Hussein screamed, and he says, Bunayya Ali, ba'daka dunya al-afa. My son Ali, after your martyrdom, nothing left for your father Hussein alayhi salam. Imam Hussein returned to the tent and he told the rest of the family, please go pick your brother Ali al-Akbar. They ask Imam Hussein, why don't you pick? You are the one who pick all the shuhada. Bring them to the tent. He said, Wallahi, I have no strength to pick Ali al-Akbar. Why, Ya Aba Abdullah? He said, Kullama rafatu janiba, tasaqat al-janib al-akhar. He said, anytime I pick one side of Ali al-Akbar, the other part of him falls into pieces. I cannot lift Ali al-Akbar. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi rajoon. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. Ya Allah, we ask you, these tears, this majlis, Ya Allah, send the thawab to the ruh of this marhum, Sayyid Faiz Ahmed Zaidi, son of Sayyid Ali Muhammad. May Allah be pleased with his soul. Surah Al-Mubarakat Al-Fatiha. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هو الله أحد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد ولم يكن له كفوا أحد. صدق الله العلي العظيم.